Number one, it was divided in thirds. Only a third of it went to creating new jobs. A third of it went to give tax cuts to modest income Americans for a change so they could afford to go to the grocery store and keep the local grocer in business. A third of it went to aid the state and local governments so we wouldn't have to lay off a million teachers and healthcare workers or raise taxes to keep them on. Either one would have been a disaster in this economy. The third of it that went to jobs went to roads and bridges and water systems and clean energy systems, and every independent audit says they created more jobs than they were estimated to create. This kept it from being worse. And since most of it's one-time spending, it won't contribute much to the long-term debt. As soon as the economy comes back, that part of the deficit will go away. By contrast, after I left you with four surpluses, paid $600 million down on national debt, and had America on track to being completely out of debt for the first time since 1832 by 2013, the opposition to Kendrick doubled the debt of the country in a time of economic growth and managed to produce only 2.5 million jobs doing it as compared to 22.7 million, 10 times as many in irate years. And that was before the meltdown started. So you got to think about this when these people criticize him on the stimulus. That was the right thing to do. Now, let me tell you something about health care. Forget about the compassionate experts, the fact that families can have to keep kids on their family policy until 26, the fact that small businesses and individuals, when we get it set up, are going to be in buying pools and be able to compete for a change instead of just being dictated to. Just forget about all the humanitarian aspects. Look at the economics. We're spending 17% of our income on health care. No other rich country spends more than 10.5% of any size. That's Canada. Germany and France are generally thought to have the best systems. They spend 10%. You know what that means? That means every year, you want more jobs? Every year, we create for ourselves a $1 trillion hole, paying for health care that does not make us healthier. Last year, when the economy was tanking and it hit rock bottom, profits for health insurance companies went up 26%. Well, and they said, oh, well, health care costs have gone up. All that money gone to health care costs, their profits wouldn't have gone up 26%. Only 19 states in this country have the power to regulate health insurance rates the way utility rates are regulated, even though for all practical purposes, most states have monopolies where one or two companies dominate the market. So what does that health care bill do about it? It gives every state $1 billion to plan to control health care costs. It gives, and it has a law that says, a rule that says, 85% of your premium from now on has to go into health care, not in the overhead and paperwork and profits. That's why I voted for it. Is it a perfect bill? No. We'll have to work on it every single year for 5 years. But until we cover everybody and do something to limit the explosion of paperwork costs, which is 30 cents on the dollar alone, we are never going to hold to this, and we cannot afford to spot every other country in the world $1 trillion before anybody ever goes to work. We can't afford it. So it's the right thing to do. This financial regulation bill that all the other party voted against, it was designed to do a couple of things. One, to make sure that the Securities and Exchange Commission can't go AWOL again like they did for the last 8 years. And two, to make sure that we can't have undue risk. So all these derivatives, I won't go into all the details, but basically, I'm from a farm state. You know, I grew up in Arkansas. I was the governor there 12 years. We like derivatives, meaning farmers have to hedge against the prices going down. Are the prices of their base products going too high?
Oh, no.
But they got a dog in the hunt. And they have to be able to prove if they lose, they can pay their gamble. What happened when we started gambling on home mortgages is people on both sides didn't have a dog in the hunt and there were no rules. So we're going to have rules. That's what the Congress did. It was a good thing to do. And the other thing they did, after the price of a college education went up 75% after inflation in the last 8 years, is to change the way the college loan program works.
Yo.
So you borrow the money direct from the government at lower interest rates, more people will pay it back. Who's got more money than he does? Here's, I can see that, the difference. One guy's delivered for you, the other guy has more money and runs more ads. And then he's got people running against him in the general, a Republican and a third party candidate who was a Republican, saying whatever they're saying. But this is a doing time. We need the doers up there. People who are going to keep working at this, and people who have promised. I want to honor the Republicans. They've been very honest. They said, if you vote for us, we're going to do exactly what we did before. We're going to go back and deep cut taxes for the special interests and upper income people. And we don't care if there's a lot of evidence. You know, they tried it 12 years before I became president. They quadrupled the debt. Then they tried it 8 years after. Unbelievably, they doubled it again when it was a whole bunch bigger. We produced 50% more jobs than they did in the first 12 years, in our only 8 years, and 10 times as many as they did in the next 8 years. It's not like there's no evidence here. You know what works. What works is when you invest in the American people and invest in the job creators. Now, here's why this is so important. We got plenty of money to get out of this. There are three things that matter here. You worry about the economy. Where's the money going to come from to invest? What's it going to be invested in? And where are the workers going to come from? How do we get the workers in good jobs? That's what matters. Okay, here's where the money's going to come from. The big companies in this country have $1.6 trillion in the bank they haven't invested in. I talked to a guy who works 100,000 people last week, and he said if he had clarity on about three things, he put 10,000 more people to work. Even more important, the banks have $1.8 trillion in reserves uncommitted to loans, which means they can make $18 trillion in loans at conservative risk. That's enough to take the world out of this mess. And we got lots of foreign investment coming in for the first time in a long time. So the money's there. The problem is the cat on the stove problem. You know the old story about if a cat sits on a hot stove? The good news is it'll never sit on a hot stove again. The bad news is it won't sit on a cold stove again. We are in the cold stove phase of this. Figuring out how to get this money loose is a practical problem, not an ideological one. You need people who can sit down and make a deal. Ever since I first met this guy, when he was in the Florida State Police, rising up the ranks to become from a trooper to an officer, I've been impressed with how much common sense he has. He always wants to understand how everything works. He also wants to know what you can do to make it better. That's all he thinks about all the time. What are you going to do? We got enough talkers. We need the doers in Washington.